Media Quality. I'm Sane Dlamini. Today on Politics 360, political analyst Ibrahim Fakir unpacks the local government elections, to be or not to be. Ibrahim, given the fact of the COVID-19 pandemic, there seems to be some who are arguing against South Africa going ahead with its planned local government elections, which we are expecting later this year. You describe in your column that the ruling ANC is schizophrenic and ambivalent about this issue. Why do you say this?
Well, they're obviously ambiguous and ambivalent about whether it should go ahead because there are many considerations for them, right? But the first, before we get to the considerations, is that contextually, the ANC at the moment is so fractured and fractious. It is both factional and fractional. And the factions are not actually based on a set of ideas, or are they not mobilizing around certain programs and so on. But whatever the diagnosis of that, that's a separate question. We can take it for granted that it is fractious and it is problematic. So that's the major context of where they're coming from. Now, inside that kind of factionalized and fractious party, there are multiple views about what should happen. Now, one of those is, remember, the EFF on the one hand is arguing that because we're in the state of pandemic, and there's some merit to this argument, that it should be delayed. Now, their proposal is that it must be delayed right until 2024, when it must be held with all the other national and provincial elections, what they call harmonized elections. Now, there's a portion of the ANC who go along with that view, because they believe, well, it will be cheaper, and it isn't actually, that it will be more easily administered because all the elections are at one time, voter turnout will be higher, it will cost less, and actually, all the contrary is true. It may cost a little bit less, the saving will be marginal, but there are deep political and democratic problems with doing so. But all of that aside, that's also a different argument. So they go along with that view, saying, postpone it, let it be held once and for all, because we also agree with the harmonization of the election. Okay, so that's one view. There's a second view which says, no, we must go ahead. We must go ahead because we can't let the term of office be prolonged because it would be unconstitutional. The law and the constitution prescribe 5 years and 90 days, so therefore we must be compliant. But there's a political argument underlying that too, even though that is legally sound. Political argument is that they obviously want to assess what the balance of forces in ANC language is in terms of strengths and weaknesses and who's on which side and how well are they going to perform. The third is that, remember, they come out and into this election on a fairly bruising 2016 local government election, and the 2019 national elections they dropped, right, support. So they are obviously a bit nervous about that, but particularly the 2016 local government elections in all of the economic heartlands where the real engines of growth and redistribution, and where you want influence over that sector of society, they basically lost that. They only recaptured it through institutional engineering and, you know, cobbling together minority governments and cobbling together certain coalitions, and especially if you think Joburg, Pretoria, PE, primarily, they've lost the overall influence in those areas. So it's very difficult election to go into. And fourthly, there's the credibility crisis for the ANC. I mean, this is the party in government. The party in government is suffering a major credibility crisis, not just because of the kind of evidence and stories which are emerging at the Zondo Commission, but if you think about the most immediate effects of not just load shedding, but institutional decay. And when you really think about it, COVID-related corruption, whether it's from people involved in the party or people in the state, very little disciplinary action, and then you add on to that the seemingly botched procurement of vaccines and the rollout of vaccine programs. So this is multiple crises in the party, different views based on different arguments about what should happen with the 2021 local government election, and you get multiple different views. But, you know, objectively speaking, they go into this election, or would go into it, with a credibility crisis. And I think that's the biggest thing. I mean, it would be foolhardy for a government to go in on the back of such major procurement corruption in COVID-19 and a seemingly botched vaccine rollout, even though President Ramaphosa has promised over the last day or two that they've signed a deal with Johnson & Johnson, who will produce vaccines locally, both for us and the African continent, in PE, right, at the manufacturing plant. So that might speed up rollout. But we don't know whether that rollout will be in time to ensure herd immunity or population immunity by the time the local government elections roll around. And the final date by which the local government elections have to be held is the first week of November.
And now we also now have the DA saying that the elections should go ahead. Can you please explain their reasoning on this matter?
Well, I mean, obviously the best people to ask would be the DA themselves. But I mean, from the public pronouncements they've made, their argument is that, look, you can't willy-nilly extend the term of office, and there is some merit to that argument. Constitutionally, these are the parameters, that's the boundaries which we have to follow. Otherwise, the exercise of public authority would in fact be illegitimate, right? And it would be extraordinary. It would almost be tantamount to a usurpation of power in some cases. Then the second argument is that, look, if you simply make a contingency arrangement now and you postpone it, you're putting in place a precedent, and you're setting a precedent which will willy-nilly allow all kinds of undemocratic actions to take place in the future, where you will simply suspend elections on flimsy excuses and so on. So, look, even that argument has some merit to it. But I think we must be practical. The practicality is we don't know some of the evolution, the pathology, the etiology of the disease and how it's going to spread and what the patterns are. I mean, there's some signs which we know and some things are known, but there are things which are unknown. We don't know about its mutations and so on. We don't know if we have an election whether it will end up being a super spreader event or not be a super spreader event. We don't know if there will be a vaccine rollout by that time and whether we will have what's called population immunity to be able to safely have the election. So there's certain things which are known, certain things which are unknown, and certain things which are unknowable. So in the practicality, I think we have to be reasonable and think that, look, there is an opportunity. If you invoke this doctrine of necessity, which is known jurisprudentially worldwide, where, you know, it's a necessary kind of emergency situation of imminent public danger that you want to avoid the spread of a disease, you can invoke this, but the invocation of it will require a public debate in Parliament, it will require a majority vote, and most importantly, it will require two things, the rationality and the real reasoning behind the postponement, and the second is that there must be a strict timeline, and one would advise not invoke this justification for more than a year. So practically, you could think to cater for a rollout effectively and to have population immunity, one can think about a timeline of 6 to 8 months. So those three important characteristics must be there when that justification is invoked. The rationale, the reasoning, the rationality, the time frame, and the contingency measure. So it's some kind of transitionary arrangement.
And the EFF is also arguing now that the local election should be postponed, possibly held simultaneously, as you've just said. But do you think that this assessment is fair to the South Africans?
Look, there's a degree of rationality in that. It's not an argument entirely without merit, but the argument is meritorious only halfway. And that is that right now, it seems that it would not be safe, it would be imprudent to actually have the election given the conditions where there's these things which are known and unknown, and some which are even unknowable. But it is not enough to say that because that justification is satisfied, we must simply postpone it and collapse it with all of the other elections. The most prudent is to say, yes, there's merit in postponement, but the postponement can only happen and should ideally only happen for up to a maximum of a year, by which time a vaccine rollout will happen. We will have a slightly clearer and perhaps better idea and know certain things to a greater degree, and then it would be safer. But certainly the idea that you can prolong and extend this term of office indefinitely until the next election, no, that's a no-go.
Speaking about the vaccine, because it's a major factor in looking at if this country will be able to hold these elections or not, do you think that our government, looking at what we've seen previously with the other vaccines arriving and we're having issues, do you think that now that they've announced this Johnson & Johnson deal, do they have like a clear mandate on what will happen, or are you still in the dark if our government will be able to deliver as they promised?
Look, that's a question of confidence in government operations, and I think they're slightly clearer. So there are two different parts to this argument. You know, the first part was that, sure, we import certain vaccines, but we weren't sure about what the efficacy is under certain conditions with the specific strain in South Africa. When the science about that got better, a snap decision was made. Of course, it was a rational decision. It can be justified. But on this new vaccine, there is clearer science about what its efficacy is. So the idea that the procurement of this specific set of vaccines, I think, is appropriate. On the question of rollout, of course, they've already identified 2,000 odd sites to do so. So rollout could reasonably and potentially happen. Of course, on the downside, we've had incidences of corruption, we've had inefficiencies, we've had ineffectiveness, maladministration. So I have no doubt that there will be a few more bottlenecks. But I think if you say suspend and invoke the doctrine of necessity, extend the election period or the term of office of the current local councils by 6 to 8 months, by then we should be able to roll out things, and hopefully we can then hold an election. At that point, if government inefficiencies are so widespread and world scale that we don't actually have the required population immunity and a large scale mass rollout of the vaccine program, at that point you can then say, look, now we've given the extension, we've tried everything, we have to have the election to legitimize new office bearers in the exercise of public authority.
And do you think that if the extension does happen, will it maybe be in favor of the ruling party?
That's impossible to tell. Of course, if they get things going in that 6 to 8 months, there's a little more coherence. Look, there's never going to be complete coherence because the fractures is just far too deep. It will take more time. But they can have slightly better coherence. That's the first thing. The second is that if there is an effective vaccine rollout and the economy and society gets back to be able to doing near what it used to be able to do, and one wonders whether we'll ever reach that stage soon. But if it becomes near that stage and there's an effective rollout, once there's effective rollout, some confidence in government does go up, and on that obviously has some kind of impact on confidence levels on the current incumbent party. But it won't be that great. It won't be so cataclysmic that, they'll eclipse every other party, or they'll eclipse all of the negative perceptions, credibility-wise, which have attached to them. But remember, Sunny, it will help the ANC, or it will help the incumbent party to a certain degree. Remember, their problems are much more widespread. It's not simply about the failure of vaccine rollout. It is about a whole range of other things, and that credibility crisis doesn't suddenly disappear. But what it does do is that it does bolster greater confidence, it does restore a degree of credibility in the ANC, and they can leverage that over that period when the election does in fact roll around, if there is a very successful vaccine rollout. But you know, even if there isn't, right, and we do have the election under current conditions, it's possible to do so. We'll have to be a little creative about whether you expand the election period over 2 days or so, so to be able to split the number of voters who go to a voting station. But it would be expensive because it would require a greater amount of sanitation, a compliance with health protocols. All of those things cost. They're costly. You will be using staff for a longer period of time, even the temporary staff which are used to administer the elections. You will be using the venues for a longer period. So those costs all start to mount up. Second, you could potentially have some election fatigue where voters get tired of, saying this is dragging on forever and ever. The third is that there is then fears around the management and the election administration process, because you've got to store the ballots securely. There may be fears that there will be ballot stuffing, that there will be electoral irregularities. that people will be stealing ballots or stuffing ballots, that there will be changes in papers. And, you know, in a society which is already this fractious, which is tense, it could be a very easy point of conflict. So you've got to be careful about those things. And then lastly, one has to wonder if under the conditions we're on now, how possible would it be to be able to have effective election campaigns, outreach, going door to door, or having mass rallies, which may in fact be out of the question in the temporary period. So new and innovative, creative ways around both processing, administering and managing the election, but also doing the political work of campaigning. They have to be very creative about that.
That was Ibrahim Fakir in conversation with Polity about the local government elections, to be or not to be.